This is Rio of Madison Rising, and you're listening to our acoustic version of the Star Spangled Banner here on KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so bright? Broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. Oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets ran.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign. KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark. God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Saturday and Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on KLRN Radio and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Each of my programs are being saved so that you can listen to them at any time. There's just 4 simple steps to find the past programs. Go to www.spreaker.com. That's S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com. Enter my name, Richard Hardin, in the search box in the top center of the home page. Click on the brown icon, which has the Bible, 2 candlesticks, and a cross in the background. A list of my programs will come up.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Hardin.
Welcome to God's Pure Word of Faith. I'm Richard Hardin, and again, I want to thank the Lord and the management of KLRN Radio for this great opportunity to share God's Word with you today. If you're out there listening today and you're lonesome, or you have a loved one or a friend that's lonesome, a child or a cousin, or, you know, somebody like this that you know that's looking for a mate, praying and seeking for a husband or a wife or something like this, listen in today's program and see how Isaac received his wife from the Lord. Abraham was promised, you know, that he was going to be the father of a great nation. And here he finally, in his old age, was able to have a child of promise, Isaac. Now, Isaac is about 40 years old, and he hasn't met anybody, or he hasn't got a wife. And Abraham said, Lord, you know, you promised me, you know, generations to come and everything, you know, father of great people and everything, but my son needs a wife. And see how that God provided a wife for Isaac. And it'll, you know, in every area of our life, we need to be seeking the Lord and praying about his will. And naturally, this is going to come from, you know, just seeking God's will and putting his will first. So the greatest thing you could do right now in sharing with someone or for yourself is to set yourself to seek the Lord the best you can for God's will in your life, your special holy calling. And then as you're doing that, you will meet someone who's seeking their special holy calling. You'll meet someone that's serving God and everything. And as y'all get to know each other, as y'all serve maybe side by side or something, or aware of each other's activities and serving the Lord and their love for the Lord, you'll see that, hey, you know, we could probably help each other and do a better job, the two of us, than just each of us individually. And God will bring you together then. And then see your special calling and the other person's special calling would be complementary. You can come together and seeking to serve the Lord together. And that's the way, you know, it should be such a joy of bringing people together in unity. You know, unity in spirit and unity in purpose and goal and mission and everything. But before I get started in this, if you want to follow along with me in the scriptures, it'll be in Genesis chapter 24. And you can just read right along with me or something today. But right now I want to share with you about my website, because I have so much information on my website that short messages, 10 to 15 minutes on different subjects, on YouTube that you can get to directly from a link in my website, for some messages also on the blog that's connected to my website, and just like it, 6 books. Anyway, I'll let this little spot give you that information.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Welcome back now. First, I want to read to you the covenant, or the agreement God had made with Abraham to start off this special group of people he had. You know, he separated Abraham out, and his family and descendants were supposed to be, you know, the light to the world, supposed to be to show people what he wanted to do for his children, or, you know, his loved ones in those days. They weren't children of God like we are today with Christ in our heart. You know, we're adopted into the family of God, but that was part of it that was missing in the Old Testament that God changed for the new covenant and sending Jesus and everything. But even in that day, he wanted his people, his special people, the Jews, you know, the Israelites that became called, he wanted them to be the light to the world. Like David said in Psalm 67, said, God be merciful and bless us and cause your face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving health among all the nations. And then when they were dedicating the new temple, Solomon and God, the promises all were there that if people would come before the temple and pray, he'd heal them, he'd, you know, bless them. Whatever problem they had, he would solve their problem. Even if he was punish them, he would forgive them. But then there was a blessing there in 1 Kings chapter 8. There was a blessing. He said, and if a stranger from any place on earth come and humble himself before the temple and call out to me, I'll answer them too. See, so the temple wasn't just for the Jews. The Jews built a temple and everything, and it was located in Jerusalem. But it was for every person on earth. God loved everybody. He said, if anybody will do this. So see, salvation or your relationship with God has always been open to everybody on earth that can, you know, come and turn to the Lord and call out to him. Now, but when God called Abraham out in Genesis chapter 12, the Lord said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house into a land that I will show you. Now see, to walk by faith, that means you've got to accept what God says to you. Accept and obey. Abraham did. He accepted, obeyed, and walked by faith. Now, but in verse 2 and 3, he goes on to say, I will make of thee a great nation. I will bless thee, make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I'll bless them that bless thee, and I'll curse them that curse thee. And in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. See, they were supposed to be the light to the world, the priest throughout the world. Now, the Levites were the priest to the Israelites and everything, but they were supposed to be a nation of priests. Well, it says that we are that way today as Christians. We're supposed to be, we're a holy people, a priest of the world, you know, and so he's made us as kings and priests and to those around us, and we're supposed to be like serving God like that in our daily life. Now, there's some problems that Abraham ran into like that. He and Sarah were getting so old and everything. They had a son. Abraham had a son from a Hagar, you know, a servant, and that wasn't a son of promise, though. The son of promise was supposed to be through Abraham and his wife Sarah, God's choice. Well, finally, at about 100 years old, something like that, well, Abraham and Sarah had a son, Isaac. Well, as he grew up, you know, he didn't have a wife. Now, in chapter 24 that we're going to start here, Abraham's son Isaac is about 40 years old. And Abraham's wondering, and, you know, he talked to the Lord and said, you know, you promised me, you know, be the father of many nations, and my son, you know, is not married, or, you know, it's not going along, as, you know, that he's with as he thought it should. But anyway, the Lord then had Abraham to send back over to his homeland to take a wife from his people. And this is in Genesis 24 then. It says, when Abraham was old and everything, the Lord had blessed him with all kind of wealth and things like this. And so Abraham had a servant that he had, you know, had given a lot of responsibility. His servant controlled his household and helped him and everything. It was like his, you know, general manager or something. But anyway, Abraham called his servant in and said, I want you to go back over to my homeland and get a wife for my son Isaac. And he said, and Abraham said unto his elder servant, this is in verse 2, that ruled over his household and everything, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh, and I will make thee swear by the Lord, the God of heaven, the God of earth, that thou shalt not take a wife unto my son of the daughters of the Canaanites among whom I am living or dwell. But thou shalt go unto my country, to my kindred, and take a wife unto my son Isaac. And the servant said, well, what if she won't come back with me? Anyway, and Abraham said unto him, beware that thou bring not my son thither again. You know, don't take my son anywhere else. But he wanted a wife from his homeland. The God had promised him, you know, it'd be his seed and everything that would, you know, throughout the ages, that would be taken care of, and it would be through Abraham's seed and his family and everything. Well, seems that the servant was kind of hesitant here. You know, him going over to a strange land to him, and said, what if she won't come back with me? What if she'll not be willing to follow me? He said, if she's not, then that's okay. You will be clear from, you know, this oath that you're giving me to, you know, go get a wife for my son. Just don't bring my son, you know, a wife from anywhere else. Okay, and the servant put his hand under the thigh of Abraham, his master, and swear to him concerning the matter. Now, here's how the servant, the importance of this chapter in this is, how did the servant find God's will for Isaac, you know, to receive a wife that he knew was God's choice? Finding this particular woman would be a chore, you know, go across to a strange land that the servant probably wasn't familiar with or anything, and then find a woman and it be God's will to be, you know, Isaac's wife. Okay, the servant took 10 camels. You know, his master was real rich and everything, Abraham was, and he was in charge of all the, you know, goods of his master. He took 10 camels and a lot of gold earrings and bracelets and things like this with him. He could have gone over and probably bought any woman that he wanted to or something like that with all the wealth and everything he carried with me to give to him, but that wasn't the point. And you'll see throughout this, that the servant's purpose was to fulfill his master's desire, but to make sure that he brought back God's woman that was to marry Isaac. So now it said he made his camels as he went back over to Mesopotamia unto the city of Nahor. That's where Abraham had come from. When he got there, it happened to be in the afternoon and everything, but he made his camels in to kneel down without the city by a well of water at the time of the evening when it was time for women to go out to draw water. In the cool of the afternoon, the young ladies would come out and get the water and, you know, to take back to their families and everything for the next day and stuff. Well, when he got there, he prayed. Now, this is how he went about finding God's will for the perfect woman that God wanted him to take back. And a lot of times we're faced with things in our life too where we need to know exactly what God wants us to do. Sometimes not, but there comes times when we do need to know God's perfect will in different situations. And naturally it will come by talking to God. And that's what the servant did. See, he prayed. Well, prayer is talking to the Lord. Then God would provide an answer. But the way you talk to the Lord and pray, you'll see here how the servant prayed in a way that when God answered him, his answer was identifying the correct woman to him. Well, listen at his prayer. O Lord God of my master Abraham, I pray thee, send me good speed this day and show kindness to my master. Behold, I stand here by the well of water, and the daughters of the men of the city come out to draw water. Let it come to pass that the damsel, or the young lady, to whom I say, let down thy pitcher, I pray thee, that I may drink, and she shall say, now this is what this particular woman is supposed to answer back to him, drink, and I will also give thy camels drink too. See, she'll answer back, I'll not only give you a drink of water, but I'll water your 10 thirsty camels. Now, see, that's not going to be an accident if a young woman comes along and says that, because going up and down the well, bringing the water out for 10 thirsty camels and everything, because, see, he hasn't watered them yet. He just came up to the well, and they camped there waiting. Okay, this is prayer again. Let the young lady to whom I shall say, let down thy pitcher, I pray thee, that I may drink. And she shall say, drink, and I will give thy camels drink also. Let the same be she that thou hast appointed for thy servant Isaac. Thereby shall I know that thou hast shown kindness to my master. See, he's saying that, you know, if she volunteers even more than just giving him a drink, but to water his 10 thirsty camels, that would be an act of God for somebody to just come out and do that, some young lady, you know, because that would be a lot of effort and everything. It wouldn't just be somebody saying it lightly, you know, something like that. Now, giving somebody a drink of water, you know, any girl that comes out to get some water there and you ask them for a drink of water, they probably would give you a drink of water, being kind and friendly and everything. But to water 10 camels, see, it's going to have to be God speaking through that person. Well, and it came to pass, before he had done speaking, that behold, Rebekah came out, who was born to Bethuel, the son of Milcah, and it goes on and tells the wife of Nahor. Nahor was Abraham's brother. So, see, it was one of the women from Abraham's family. So, God had led him straight to a member of Abraham's family, and that's what Abraham had told him to go do. Go bring a, you know, wife from his family. And she had her pitcher on her shoulder. Well, she says she was very pretty and fair to look upon, a virgin. Neither had any man known her. And she went down to the well and filled her pitcher and came up. See, she was going down to get the water and coming up, you know, the stairs and everything. And a servant ran to meet her and said, let me, I pray thee, drink a little water of thy pitcher. And she said, drink, my lord. And she hasted and let down her pitcher upon her hand and gave him drink. And when she had done giving him drink, see, kind of a hesitation there from offering and giving him a drink and everything and answering the full amount of the servant's prayer. It you know, because like I said, it would probably have to be pulled out of somebody. And the Lord was going to make her say that because it was his will for her to, you know, go back to be Abraham's, Isaac's wife. But he says, after she hesitated and everything like that, and then she let down her pitcher upon her hand and gave him drink. And when she had done giving him drink, she said, I will draw water for thy camels also until they have done drinking. See, she says she's going to do the whole job, complete it, until they've done drinking. She hasted and emptied her pitcher into the trough and ran again into the well to draw water and drew for all his camels, 10 thirsty camels. And the man, now he's sitting over here, the servant is wondering at her, held his peace. He didn't say anything. And it, to whether the Lord had made his journey prosperous or not. And it came to pass, as the camels had done drinking, that the man took a golden earring then, when he saw that she had completed what she said she was going to do. She didn't get halfway through and stop. She watered all the camels. He got out from his hands, you know, two bracelets and, you know, earrings. And he said, whose daughter art thou? Tell me, I pray thee, is there room in thy father's house for us to lodge in? He was talking about, you know, that there were some men with him and the 10 camels and stuff. And she said unto him, I am the daughter of Bethuel, the son of Milcah, which she bare to Nahor. And again, Nahor was Abraham's brother. And she said moreover unto him, we have both straw and food enough and room to lodge in. So the man bowed down his head and worshipped the Lord. And now this was his thanksgiving prayer, because see, he recognized in, as you know, from Abraham's family, and God had identified her to him through her, you know, answering the prayer that the servant had prayed in a way that the servant knew now that it was Rebekah's, you know, if God's will for Rebekah to be Isaac's wife. So here's his blessing prayer to God. He said, blessed be the Lord God of my master Abraham, who has not left destitute my master of his mercy and truth. Now, I being in the way, the Lord led me to the house of my master's brethren. He said, you know, just it amazed him, you know, that going across that desert and everything like that, he was able to just go straight to. But remember, Abraham had promised his servant that his God, the angel of his God, would go before him and lead him and guide him to the woman that God wanted to be Isaac's wife. But it still amazed him, though, because going across that desert and everything, and, you know, just happened to stop in this part of the city, and, you know, he was there thirsty, and here comes the answer to his prayer almost immediately. And Rebekah had a brother, his name was Laban, and Laban ran out to the man at the well. Well, she had gone back in the previous verse to her house and told the people. Anyway, her brother comes back out. And it came to pass when he saw the earrings, bracelets in his sister's hands, and when he heard the words of Rebekah, his sister, saying, thus spake the man unto me, that he came unto the man, and behold, he stood by the camels at the well. And he said, come in, thou blessed of the Lord. Now, this is Laban telling the servant to come in, thou blessed of the Lord. Wherefore standest thou without? For I have prepared the house and the room for the camels. And the man came into the house, the servant came into the house, and he ungirded his camels and gave them straw or food and provender for the camels and water to wash his feet and the men's feet that were with him. And then, after feeding the camels and watering them, they went in, it says, and there was set meat before him, the servant. But the servant said, I will not eat until I have told my errand. And then Laban said, speak on. See, he was putting God's will first in everything he did. As soon as he got to town, he prayed to find out which woman should I take back to be Isaac's wife. Now he's sitting here with the family of Rebekah and her brother and the others of the family. And they're wanting to eat. And I'm sure he was hungry and everything too. But he says, no, I'm not going to eat until I tell my story, my mission, everything. And so then he said, I am Abraham's servant. Well, they knew who Abraham was. You know, it was their grandfather's brother. And the Lord had blessed him greatly. He's become great. He's given him flocks and herds and gold and maidservants, men servants, camels, and all this. And Sarah, my master's wife, bare a son to my master. And when she was old, and to him had he given all that he has. So Abraham has transferred everything he has, it says, to Isaac, you know. Yeah. My master made me swear, saying, thou shalt not take a wife to my son of the daughters of Canaanites, but thou shalt go into my father's house and to my kindred and take a wife unto my son. And I have said to my master, peradventure the woman will not follow me. And, Abraham had told him, the Lord before whom I walk will send his angel with thee and prosper thy way. Now, see, that's prosperity. When you know you're walking in the Lord's will, you can see the Lord working with you and guiding you like that. That's prosperity. You're headed to the most prosperous area of your life, you know, when you can know God's presence like that, answering your prayer and back and forth. Said, I shall take a wife of my son, of my kindred, and of my father's house. Then shall thou be clear of this my oath, when thou comest to thy kindred, and if they give not thee one, or they don't give you a woman, thou shalt be clear of my oath. See, if you get there, your mission is fulfilled. If you get there and do and share with them, and they don't send somebody back with you, you know, like that, saying, then you're clear of the oath. See, the servant said, so I came this day into the well of water. Now, he goes through and repeats what he did out at the well in praying and seeking God's will. And it's time for our break now, so I'll share that and the rest of this story with you when I get right back.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign. KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Saturday and Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on KLRN Radio and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Each of my programs are being saved so that you can listen to them at any time. There's just 4 simple steps to find the past programs. Go to www.spreaker.com. That's spreaker.com. Enter my name, Richard Hardin, in the search box in the top center of the home page. Click on the brown icon, which has the Bible, 2 candlesticks, and a cross in the background. A list of my programs will come up.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author, Richard Hardin.
I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
That's such a beautiful song. And the story behind it is, too, of a slave trader getting saved and seeing all the evil he had done and everything, and God delivering him of it. He says, I was blind, but now I see. And I can remember the time the Lord changed my heart, and I feel that same way myself. You know, I was blind all those years, but now I see. Now, our story today is about how God provided a wife for Abraham's son Isaac. Abraham sent his, you know, his chief servant over, back over to his homeland, to his family, his brother Nahor, and to get a wife from his kinfolks. In that day, you know, that's the way they did it. We didn't have the problems with the relationships like we have today. The servant goes over, he gets by a well of water, and he prays, and God reveals to him then that Rebekah is the one. Rebekah's brother comes out and meets him and talks to him and welcomes him to their home. When they get there, the servant then feeds his camels and all of this, and the food and the water, 10 thirsty camels. And then they want to sit down and eat. Well, the servant is still concerned about completion of his mission. His mission is to find the woman to bring back to be his master's son's wife, Isaac's wife. And he's identified him. He knows that it's God's will now for Rebekah to go back with him. God's identified her to him. But see, nobody else knows that yet, because he's the one that prayed, and he received God's answer and identified Rebekah to him. Now he's back over talking to the family, and he's going to share with them how he knows that it's God's will for him to take Rebekah back, and then see what they will do. Well, he gets to their house, and he's rehearsing this to the father, Bethuel, and Laban, the brother, and the rest of the family members that are around there. But it was the men of the families then that had control of what to do and everything for the women and their family and everything. So he's telling them how he knows that Rebekah is the one that God wants him to take back. This is in Genesis chapter 24, and this starts in verse 42. Goes in 42, and he explains to the family then. He said, and I came this day into the well of water. And they knew what he was talking about, you know, the one out by the city where the young women go every evening like that to get water and bring back for the next day. He says, I came this day to the well and said, this is his prayer that he's sharing with them. O Lord God of my master Abraham, if now thou do prosper my way which I go. And again, he uses the word prosper. See, prosperity is seeking God's will. Prosperity in all of your life, you know, like that, is not just money. Man, when you need a healing and everything like that, money won't help you get that healing. It's you got to prosper in your soul, in your mind, and in your, you know, emotions and everything, and placing them on the Lord and seeking him, putting him first properly in your life. That's where prosperity comes from. In any area of your life that you're having a problem with, prosperity is to seek and know God's will and purpose. Okay, Abraham says, if thou wilt prosper my wife, which I go, the way which I go, behold, I stand by the well of water, and it shall come to pass that when a virgin cometh forth to draw water, and I say to her, give me, I pray thee, a little water of thy pitcher to drink. And she shall say to me, both, drink thou, and I will also draw water for your camels. See, he's just going to ask her for her to give him a drink. But then God's going to have her add into that, I'll water your, you know, 10 thirsty camels. And he's telling that to the family, how he prayed. That she will say, both, drink thou, or that she would give him a drink, and I will also draw water for thy camels. Let the same be the woman whom the Lord has appointed out for my master's son, for Isaac's, you know, wife. And before I had done speaking, in my heart, God, behold, Rebekah came forth with her pitcher on her shoulder, and she went down to the well, drew water, and I said to her, let me drink, I pray thee. And she made haste and let down her pitcher from her shoulder and said, drink, and I will also give thy camels drink. So I drank, and she made the camels drink also. Well, he watched her and everything. He said, I asked her and said, whose daughter art thou? And she said, the daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son. And Nahor was Abraham's brother. So it's Abraham's nephew's daughter is Rebekah. And I put the earrings upon her face and the bracelet upon her hand. And I bowed down my head and worshiped the Lord and blessed the Lord God of my master Abraham, which had my master's brother's daughter unto his son. Now, and now if ye will deal kindly, listen how he addresses the Rebekah's dad, Bethuel, and Laban. He says, now if you will deal kindly and truly with my master, tell me. And if not, tell me. See, you know, yes or no, it's only one way. Either you're going to let her go, or you're not going to let her go. But tell me, and if not, tell me, that I may turn to the right hand or to the left. See, he's done everything now he can do. He's identified how he knows it's Rebekah's, you know, that Rebekah is God's will for him to take back to be Isaac's wife. But he's right now at a standstill because everything depends on how they are going to respond to this information and what they're going to do. He said, tell me that I may turn to the right hand or to the left. Then Laban and Bethuel answered and said, listen to their answer now. And these were people back in the homeland where God had pulled Abraham out of that. But listen to their wisdom. Laban and Bethuel answered and said, the thing proceedeth from the Lord. See, they recognized it as God working in his life and then the situation of Rebekah's life too. The thing proceedeth from the Lord. We cannot speak unto thee bad or good. See, he says, they knew it had come from the Lord. They said, we can't speak unto you bad or good. You know, behold, Rebekah is before thee. Take her and go. Let her be thy master's son's wife as the Lord has spoken. They didn't say now, as you have spoken, or, you know, because we know you got a lot of money and jewelry and he'll take care of her, things like this, and wealth and everything. See, the concern here for the servant was first when he got to town, he wanted to find out which woman should I take back. Then he gets over to their house and they feed his camels and everything like that and water all those thirsty camels, and then they sit down to eat. He says, no, I don't want to eat until I've told you my story. See, finding the woman to take back and completing his mission was the top priority of that servant all the way. He tells them the story. Now, they too now see and recognize God working in this situation. And they also recognize that, you know, they better not go against God or whatever like that. They better, you know, just, you know, go along with what the servant has said here because they recognize it. It says, behold, Rebekah's before thee. Take her and go. Let her be thy master's son's wife as the Lord has spoken. Now see, when we say the Lord speaks, you see all those activities had to take place there, but they said as the Lord has spoken. We normally call when the Lord speaks to us as he identifies a message to us in our mind some way or another. You know, he can form patterns in our mind that become thoughts to us, and then we recognize them some way or another, or in our heart, or in circumstances that happen like this when we pray and ask the Lord for guidance and we recognize these things happening. See, that's included in when we say, God spoke to me. There's so many ways that God spoke to people throughout the Bible and everything, dreams and visions, and here, an answer to prayer. See, the servant was so concerned about God's will that he prayed and talked to the Lord about it. Now, that's what each of us should be doing daily in our lives too. Now, not in every one of the things that we do. He doesn't just speak to us one way all the time. We don't have to just pray a prayer like this and have him identify something to us. But when we've been praying and seeking and everything and really concerned and we do this, God will hear and answer us today this way too. There's many other examples in the scripture how God spoke to people like this by identifying to them from their prayer what he wants them to do. Well, take her and let her be thy master's son's wife as the Lord has spoken. Now that should be an encouragement to each of you to put God's will first in your life and seeking your mate, seeking that job or seeking whatever it is that you're concerned about in your life. Like, put God's will there and start praying and seeking and let him guide you in the way that he wants you to pray. See, I'm sure God had something to do with when that servant got to town, causing him to pray with those certain requirements of, you know, I'll ask for a drink of water, and the young lady that says, I'll give you a drink, and I'll water your camels too. I'm sure God had a little bit to do with guiding him to think about praying in that certain way so that God could reveal it to him. See, so he didn't just make up the prayer out of the blue by himself. God was there helping him and everything. And he'll help and guide you and me too in our situations like this. So they've identified it now as being God's will for Rebekah. And it came to pass then that when Abraham's servant heard their words, what did he do? When he was by the well of water and he found out Rebekah was the one, he worshiped and praised the Lord. Here, when they responded and said, take her and go as the Lord has spoken, the first thing the servant did when he heard their words, he worshiped the Lord, bowing himself to the ground. And then the servant brought forth the jewels of silver, gold, the bracelets and raiments and everything, and gave them to Rebekah. He gave also to her brother and to her mother them precious things. But see, he didn't give this wealth to the people, asking them to take the wealth to give them the daughter. See, he made sure it was God's will. He made sure that they agreed it was God's will and that they agreed for her to go, you know, before he ever brought forth all this wealth and everything like that. But now he's going to share it. They did eat and drink, and the men that were with him, they tarried all night. Now listen to the servant here again now. Everybody's ready for a big party. But they rose up in the morning, and he, the servant, said, send me away to my master. See, he gets up the next morning, he's ready to go. He's ready to get home and get his mission complete to take Rebekah to be Isaac's wife. Well, that wasn't their plans, you know. Anyway, and her brother, who was Laban, and her mother said, let the damsel, you know, let Rebekah abide with us a few days, at the least 10. They want to keep her around about 10 days. See, there's the procedures and everything back in those days for, you know, weddings and stuff like that. And they wanted 10 days. After that, she shall go. But now the servant, next verse, the servant said to them, hinder me not. You know, he was ready to go that morning. And they're saying 10 days. So he's saying to him, that'd be a hindrance. Hinder me not, seeing the Lord has prospered my way. See, again, he used the word prosper here. He's prospered him, you know, and that's always what prosperity is seeking and knowing God's will for your life. Because then you have everything that's required, health, strength, the means and everything, the money, whatever, to do God's will, as long as you know you're doing God's will. Okay. Hinder me not, seeing the Lord has prospered my way. Send me away that I may go to my master. Okay, in verse 57 then. And they said, we will call Rebekah, or the damsel, and inquire of her mouth. And they called Rebekah and said unto her, wilt thou go with this man? And she said, I will go. And they sent away Rebekah, their sister, and her nurse, and Abraham's servant, and his men. They blessed Rebekah and said unto her, thou art our sister, be thou the mother of thousands of millions, and let thy seed possess the gate of those that hate him. Now, thousands of millions. See, people knew and had heard and you know, had heard Abraham confess, you know, that God called him out. You know, he's going to be the father of a big nation, a special nation, everything. And Rebekah arose and her damsels, and they rode upon the camels and followed the man. And the servant took Rebekah and went his way. Now, it jumps over to Isaac. And Isaac came from the way of the well at Lahadrov, for he dwelt in the south country. And Isaac went out to meditate in the field at the evening tide. And he lifted up his eyes and saw, and behold, the camels were coming. And Rebekah lifted up her eyes. And when she saw Isaac, she lighted off the camel. For she had said unto the servant, "What man is this that walketh in the field to meet us?" And the servant said, "It is that my master." Therefore she took a veil, covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all things that he had done. Now see, he's used to telling this story. And he wants to tell Isaac, because he wants Isaac to know that he didn't just go over there and, you know, take that wealth and buy somebody to come back. He wanted Isaac to know, just like he wanted Laban and Bethuel, her dad and brother, to know what God had done to bring him to identify Rebekah and bring her back to be Isaac's wife. Now, see, Isaac's never met her or anything. And I've heard so many people, you know, or ministers, and telling this story that, you know, how would you like to get a wife like that? And somebody just bring you up a woman, you get married and everything. But see, it wasn't that way. It wasn't funny or, you know, silly or ridiculous. Isaac here had the confidence of knowing that it was God's will for Rebekah to be his wife. Now, what else would you need to know about somebody? If God thought you were to be the two people that he wanted to be together, that would mean that she would be the best for you and you would be the best for her. And, you know, what else would there be that a person would need to know to have the special choice from God to be your mate and everything? Now, so it said, and the servant told Isaac all things that he had done. And Isaac brought her into his mother Sarah's tent, took Rebekah, and she became his wife, and he loved her. And Isaac was comforted after his mother's death. Well, then see, it just, that's all there was to it. They just became married. And that's how that Isaac, Abraham's son, got his wife. But I think the most important part of this story is, over and over, the servant was so dedicated to putting in his trip back to the homeland and all this, he was so dedicated to seeking God's will that he put everything else aside, or put it back, like, you know, what they fed the camels and everything when he got there and watered them. But when it was time and they asked him to eat, he said, "No, I won't eat until I tell my story, my mission." And he did that first. You know, he put himself back and submitted to seeking God's will in everything he did. What a servant that would be. That would be the best servant anybody could ever have, one that would seek God's will for you and make sure and be obedient to God's will. He wasn't just doing it for his master. He was doing it, you know, to serve God too and to seek God's perfect will. Now, and again, as I mentioned in the beginning, if any of you are out there seeking a mate, set yourself to seek the Lord for his perfect holy calling in your life. Because in 2 Timothy 1:9 it says, "He saved us and called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, created in Christ Jesus before the world began." Now, in that holy calling, he's going to have for you a mate, whether you be a male or a female. He's going to have for you a mate or whatever. You know, like this, as you seek God's holy calling, that's how you're going to come into the situations and circumstances that will bring you to that mate, because that mate is probably going to be seeking God's holy calling for their life too. It's seeking to do God's will. And as y'all start serving kind of the Lord together and everything, and you get to know each other, and all of a sudden, you know, you'll start seeing that, hey, you know, there's going to be such an attraction between you, you know, in your mind and purpose and calling and everything. that you'll see each other then as God's choice for y'all to be together. But God will bring you together when you seek His will, your holy calling of life. So often today, though, I think so many people don't look at God's will as being the upper priority of seeking their mate. And that brings so much sadness and hurt and hardship later on in life, you know, when the things that do draw people together kind of fall by the wayside, you know, the physical, sexual attraction, or, you know, just the emotional, you know, the people say my soulmate and things like this. Well, when these things kind of fall apart, you know, what's left then? But if you come together in serving the Lord together and enjoying each other and enjoying serving the Lord, you know, that will continue to grow and grow and grow. And God is love, and His love never fails. Now, if you haven't received the Spirit of Christ in your heart, if you're not sure what I'm talking about when I talk about God's love in us or Christ in us, something like this, in Ezekiel 36:26, the scripture says, God, the new covenant He wanted with people back in Abraham's day and like that, the scripture says that His covenant with the people, in Isaiah it says, Isaiah 59:21, this is my covenant, my spirit upon them and my words to them. Psalms 25:10 says, mercy and truth, His spirit on us, and it, well, not on us, but on them, and His word, His truth to them, are all the ways of the Lord to those that, you know, obey His testimonies and covenants. Well, God wanted a better relationship. He wanted to be in us, and that's what Jesus died on the cross for. He fulfilled all the prophecies of the Old Testament. He fulfilled all the requirements for the sacrifices, for our forgiveness of our sins when we turn to the Lord, that He was raised from the dead, that His resurrection spirit would come back to live in us then, and not just on us like the Old Testament, but in us. In Ezekiel 36:26, God spoke through the prophet and told what the new covenant was going to be like. He says, a new heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I'll give you a heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you. Now see, and we get the new heart. We get forgiveness of our sins, but we get cleansing of our heart, a new, perfectly clean heart to enter into the family of God. Because see, God won't look upon sin, so you won't be bringing any sin in your heart to Him. Because He's forgiven your sins, cleansed your heart, created a new heart. We come into the family of God then with this clean, new heart, and He puts His Spirit in us to live in us. So now we're children of God. In Galatians 4:6, and because your sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore you no more a servant, but a son, if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Joint heir with Jesus, children of God. We were His creatures before, but now we're His children. And only people who are children of God are those who have received the Spirit of Christ in his heart. Romans 8:9 says, now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Now, creatures of God, but we're not a child of God. We become children of God when the Spirit of Christ comes into our heart and adopts us into the family, or like the James says in the book of James, he says, we're engrafted into the family. You know, we were just creatures of God before, but now we're engrafted in to become a limb. You know, Jesus says He's a vine, we're the branches. We become a branch, and Jesus is the source of all our, you know, substance and everything now. But we're enter into the family of God when the Spirit of Christ comes into our heart. And that's the only way. Jesus is the only way, Father. He says, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And that is true for everyone on earth. God loves everyone with a perfect love. And there's no such thing as people being predestined, born to die and go to hell, born to die to go to heaven, you know, like that. We have to make a choice. And each of you listen today, you have to make a choice to receive the Spirit of Christ in your heart. And I know it's something that if you haven't done it, you wonder, what on earth, you know, how is this going to happen? Well, I don't know. It's what we call the work of grace. when God creates in us a new heart and cleanses us, our heart, and puts His Spirit in us and everything, and or like James says, and grafts us into the family. All that is included in whatever grace is. Grace is a work of God's Spirit in our hearts to create in us all that, you know, work that takes place to change us in from just being a creature to a child, a son of God. And that's a work of grace. And then He continues to work in our heart to help us to grow closer to Him and everything as we invite more of His Spirit to come into us as we walk with Him. If we accept His words by faith into us, we grow then with the Spirit of those words in our heart. And so today, all you need to do is just a simple, honest prayer. Call out to the Lord. Lord, please forgive me my sins. Please come into my heart and save me, and I commit my life to You. You know, just with a wholehearted commitment. It's got to be wholehearted. You can't hold back part and say, I'll try it. No, you got to just jump in and say, Lord, take me. Here I am. Please forgive me. I want You. Forgive me my sins. Come into my heart and create in me that new heart and new life. John 3:16-17. For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him, Jesus, should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Now my revision is this for John 3:16. For God so loved the people of the world that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus, that Jesus should endure the loneliness, the suffering of the perfect walk of faith, and the painful sufferings of His 7 sprinklings of His blood on the cross, by the crown of thorns, the plucking of His beard, the nails in His 2 feet, the nails in His 2 hands, and the terrible stripes on His back, that Jesus would go through all this suffering. God allowed these sufferings in His mercy, so that all of God's already pre-elected, predestined people prior to birth to die and go to heaven, that they would actually die and go to heaven. That sounds so ridiculous. If only predestined or elected people prior to their birth go to heaven, then there would have been no need for the work and suffering of Jesus. No one's destiny would or will ever be changed by Jesus' suffering and death on the cross for our sins and salvation, because everything required for our salvation would have already been done prior to our birth by God's act of electing and predestining us to heaven or hell before birth. After God has predestined us to heaven or hell, there would be no need or no more to be done in heaven and earth. It would already be finished before our birth. So what's happening here is the devil hates Jesus so much that he's come up with this Calvinist, devilish, deceived theology that would have us think that we're predestined or elected prior to birth to go to heaven or hell, and that would make all the suffering and work of Jesus as our Savior totally unnecessary, totally worthless, and Jesus totally useless. For His life and death on the cross would not change anything prior to, you know, people dying and going to heaven or hell, because it's already been done by God predestining and electing them to heaven or hell before we were born. See how ridiculous that is. Good day. God bless you.
God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Saturday and Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on KLRN Radio and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Each of my programs are being saved so that you can listen to them at any time. There's just four simple steps to find the past programs. Go to www.spreaker.com. That's S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com. Enter my name, Richard Hardin, in the search box in the top center of the home page. Click on the brown icon, which has the Bible, two candlesticks, and a cross in the background. A list of my programs will come up.